On you whenever you're ready.
Okay, thank you very much, Lauren. Hello, everyone. Those who know me already, you know, I always say hello because I don't know what this time zone right now for you. So hello, good morning, good afternoon, maybe good evening if we have people from Asia. It's really nice to see you again. Today we'll be talking about Discovery Kanban, actually discovering Discovery Kanban. I make this disclaimer at the beginning to manage expectations. This is a beginner level. So what you will see, what you will hear today is very basic. And everything I will be talking to you about, you may already seen, but maybe not. Maybe some of these concepts are new for you. But if there is anything you would like to learn more about, hear more about, or see any of these concepts that we present here, or maybe something else that you are particularly interested in, please let us know. After this presentation, after this webinar, you will receive a fit for purpose survey from us. So please let us know in the survey what more you would like to learn about. And we love to hear your feedback because, as I always say, we do it for you, not for ourselves. So we would love to have you satisfied. Before we move on, I will just give you a short background of mine. Maybe some of you already know it, so I will try to keep the story short. But I hope this will give you some insights and some background. Why am I so into Discovery Kanban? Why I love this this part of the Kanban so much? So, you know, many years ago, I graduated history at Jagiellonian University in Krakow, and back then there was not so much work to do for historian. So I had to do something in my life to pay my mortgage. And I decided to start working in one of big companies in Krakow that are doing accounting as shared service centers or BPOs. And this is how my career of accountant has started. So I started really easy, you know, with easy stuff like sitting on the phone, picking up phone calls from vendors, from customers. Then I moved to more and more advanced stuff. And I realized that I really enjoy this content. I really enjoy this work. And I would like to learn more about it and be more proficient in it. And what I started to specialize in was financial management and also treasury area. And, you know, doing my daily accounting work, I also had to deal in so-called spare time. I had to deal with requests from our IT departments. And, you know, these requests were like, Anya, we are building new product. Could you please write requirements? What do you really want? Yeah, tell me what you want. So I was sitting back then doing business analyst job, which was called subject matter expert. Do not call me business analyst and pay additionally for it. So I was subject matter expert. And I was writing, gathering requirements, writing requirements documents, trying to make it clear for my colleagues from IT so they can create a beautiful, perfect product for us. What I was struggling back then was the communication. So actually different languages we speak, although we all spoke Polish or English. This meta level of language spoken was very different. And also me having lack of understanding how this whole product building works. So what I started to do, I started to learn more because, you know, I was one leg in accounting, one leg in project management. So I started to learn more how to deal with the situation. The first thing I learned was very good old classical PMI. Then Lean and Six Sigma. This is something that's still very popular here in Poland. And then naturally I discovered Agile, different Agile methods, methodologies, frameworks. One of them, of course, was Scrum. But very quickly I learned about Kanban. And actually this was, you know, like a huge discovery in my life because I could apply Kanban not only to IT, and this is something what you might have heard, that Kanban is for IT, Kanban is for maintenance, Kanban is for teams, which is not true. And I can tell it from my accountant experience that Kanban is for everyone. And then we started to introduce Kanban also in our financial reporting department, and it worked really, really well. But coming back to project management, to building products and being BA, I also had a team of business analysts, four of us, all ladies. And what I heard from them, what also overlapped with my experience, was that they feel forgotten, you know, so they feel like everyone forgot about them. So what we expect is that on the top of our backlog or at our commitment point, we have requirements, we have user stories, perfectly described, well known, everyone knows what to do. And we know that they are technically feasible to deliver. So now we can just start working on them, developing them, testing them. Yeah? But what they told me is that, you know, Anya, we are sitting in the daily meetings and we don't even know whether we should be here. Can we be in this meeting? What should we say if they ask us? It's not described anywhere. No one teaches us what to do. So we all taught by ourselves. And what I learned back then was that actually in Kanban, there is a place, special place in Kanban, where we care for you. So this is a place where we care for you, dear business analysts, product owners, product managers, dear clients, we care for you too. And today I would like to tell you about this special place for all people like this. So what is the plan for today? We'll start with what Discovery Upstream Kanban really is. Then I will tell you about the storm of ideas and courtesy to my colleague, Andreas Bartel, who always describes this place of Kanban as storm of ideas. Then we'll continue fusion cuisine. So a bit of weather, geometry, medicine, and financial management. And last but not least, let's be safe here. We'll talk about clients. So yes, there is also client, and client is super important. And we'll see why. But starting with the basics. The concept of upstream Kanban, it comes from the book Essential Upstream Kanban by Patrick Steyert. And this is the first and actually the only book about upstream Kanban that we have. And you can get access to this book from Kanban University page. Also at Kanban University, you can find the case study from Patrick. And the whole process of installing Kanban and putting Discovery and Expert Kanban in Skia, a company back in 2011, 12, 13. So I really encourage you to read this book, to read the story, because it gives you the background which may very easily resonate with you and with your situation. It resonated very well with me. So although in many situations we see that we have really well described and established delivery system, what we call downstream Kanban, this upstream system is rather cloudy and undefined. So what Patrick did and what you can read was how to manage this whole process, how to make sure that this clouds of ideas, which we call pool of ideas, will be unclouded, and that you will learn more what you are capable to deliver and what your client really wants you to deliver. And when you go to the book of Patrick, on the cover of this book, you will see the funnel. And this is the funnel of ideas. So imagining you have a backlog or pool of ideas, pool of requests, and this is the top of our funnel, yeah? So on the top, you have dozens, hundreds of these ideas that you can work on, but actually you are not sure whether all of them make sense. And sometimes you may receive a request which says, we want you to upgrade our report. This was one of the requirements I received, and it was the end, yeah? Okay, so they wanted me to upgrade the report, but what report? What upgrades? Who knows? Who cares? So this is the top of our funnel, and then we go down. And when you are in the funnel, you are in the upstream. And when you go to this pipe, you are in downstream. And what's in the funnel, which is very wide on the top, but becomes more and more and more narrow, are the options. So when we are in the upstream system, we talk about options. And what the name says, the options are optional. And if I want you to remember just one thing from this presentation, please remember that the options, the ideas in upstream system are optional, so you don't have to deliver everything. And then what you can really do with these options. But before we move on, Why should you even bother? And now a small off topic. Before we started this webinar, I had here a pizza guy. Okay, but we hear your feedback. In the last webinar, you told us that you are sick of our pizza examples. So I quickly removed this pizza guy and I put some ice cream. You know, spring is coming, summer is coming. So let's use ice cream instead of pizza this time. So coming back to the upstream system, why should you even bother? Imagine you go into the restaurant, you come into the cafe, you see the freezer. Oh, there are ice cream. You approach the freezer and what you see is the strawberry ice cream. And I don't know how about you, but I really hate strawberry ice cream. Although I love strawberries, I hate the ice cream. What I like is cream ice cream and some raisins and maybe some chocolate, but not strawberry for God's sake. And what I see in this freezer is just strawberry ice cream. So what I'm supposed to do, I probably leave this cafe, yeah? So choose whatever taste you don't like and imagine this is the only choice, actually no choice, this is the only taste you have, the only thing you can buy in this cafe. You have no other choice, you have no option. Okay, so if you go to the cafe and you want to choose, you want to have an option to buy different taste of ice creams, why would you limit yourself building your products? Make this request optional. Let yourself to choose what's the most important for you, what taste of the product you like the most, what taste of the product makes the most sense. Because, you know, I may like chocolate ice cream, but maybe this particular chocolate ice cream is made out of a chocolate or cocoa, which is very rare and very expensive. And I'm not able to afford to eat this particular taste, you know? So maybe this time I will decide to strawberry. So not only what you like the most, but only something what has the most value for you. That's why in upstream, you keep things optional. But how to manage these options? So to manage these options, we come to the concept of real options. And the concept of real options comes from financial management. So this is me right now on the white horse. So what we do in the upstream system with real options? As I said, this whole concept comes from financial management. And in financial management, we have four options, not three. And I will tell you why in a second. So in financial management, we have option to abandon, option to delay, option to expand, and option to redeploy. And all of them are related to your investment decision. Okay. So when we talk about option to abandon, this is the easiest one to explain, probably not the easiest one to make. And so when you abandon your investment, it means that based on the analysis you've made, analysis of cost benefits, what the cost that you need to bear, you see that the NPV, so net present value of your project is negative. So you don't want to bear any more costs and any costs anymore. You just want to abandon this project. You want to abandon this investment. You decide to write off all costs that you have already carried. Then you have the option to delay. So this is a situation when you see that doing these things right now doesn't make too much sense, but maybe it makes sense to do it later. Keeping things easy, let's imagine you would like to open your own restaurant, but right now in COVID times, it's maybe not the best idea. So you decide to delay this option until the circumstances, external, sometimes internal, will change and net present value of this project and this investment will be favorable again. Then we have option to expand. So maybe your restaurant isn't that profitable because you are selling only coffee, tea, and soda. But if you decide to add snacks or cookies to your offer, it's going to bring you profit. So this is the option to expand. You take your current investment, your current project, you expand it by something else, and then it becomes profitable. The last but not least, option to redeploy. This is a situation that you have already invested. Actually, investing anymore doesn't make any sense, but you can use what you have built and actually reuse what you have built in the other investment. So you write off existing costs, you close, so you abandon current project and you redeploy what you have learned in the other project. And now from the Kanban perspective, how we have applied these ideas to the upstream Kanban. So we have three options: option to invest, to shelf, and to discard. Option to invest, the easiest one. You just, this is the idea you like. This is the project you like. You want to invest in it. You want to deliver it. You choose to move these things forward up to delivery. On the other side of the scale, you have option to discard. So you know that it really doesn't make sense to invest any more time, money, effort in this. You just discard this option. In the middle, we have option to shelf, which is similar to our option to delay in financial management. So you don't know yet. The level of uncertainty is very high and you simply are not sure whether you should invest in this option or whether you should discard this option. So you shelve it. You put it in the freezer until the circumstances change or until you learn more about this option so you are capable to make a decision. So this is the first technique that we use in upstream Kanban to decide what we do with these ideas in the funnel and how to narrow them. So we narrow them by deciding what to invest, but also what to discard. Discarding options in upstream system is normal behavior. So don't be afraid of it, okay? And if we say that each idea has its mother or father, but let's take this mother figure. If you discard an idea and mother really loves her children, she will come back to you and she will tell you, okay? Because mother loves their children, no matter how ugly they are. If you see they are ugly, they want to discard them, then you do it. And if they are really important, someone will come back to you and will tell you that, no, this shouldn't be discarded. Let's talk about it. Then the second technique you can apply is triage. And you might have heard about triage, especially looking at the COVID times, triage word became popular somehow. But because not everyone heard about it, what I learned recently, I very quickly explained it. So the whole concept of triage comes from the warfare. I was not able to find, one precise moment when it was born. I guess it was the mother of evolution. But the first time we have evidence for the triage existing and being applied is mid of 19th century, the Crimean War. And triage is a technique which helps people taking care for the soldiers on the battlefield to decide whether they should really take care for this particular one or not. So we had three categories of soldiers. The first one were the soldiers who were just beyond any help. So no matter what you do, they're going to die. Then you have the second category. These are the soldiers who are lightly wounded and actually, whether you help them or not, they're going to survive. Okay, so you just move them somewhere aside from the battlefield and you take care for them later. Or you have special people who just take care for this kind of wounded soldiers. And then again, in the middle, we have the soldiers who are bleeding to death. And if we decide to help them immediately, they will survive. But if we delay, if we postpone helping them, they will die. And this technique is used right now in the hospitals where patients are categorized into different categories. Right now, there are more of them, but these three are pretty simply to explain. And what we need for upstream is a metaphorical equivalent of what's the rate the patient is bleeding to death. And our patient here is our idea. is our request. So triage helps you to answer what's the urgency of the request. Is it, you know, is it already too late to do anything with this idea? You just need to discard it. Or maybe this idea has plenty of time and you can shelve it for a moment and you can decide what to do with it later. Or maybe if you expedite this item, if you decide to do something with it now, then this idea is going to survive. If you postpone decision, if you postpone any action on this idea, it will just die and you have to discard it. So this is the technique number two. Now, what to do if you work with backlog? And all Scrum people, please forgive me. But this is like a very raw draft of the backlog. And again, all credits to Andreas Bartel, who, you know, injected this idea into my mind, and he described how he worked with the backlog, describing upstream systems. So if you work with backlog, and you can probably recognize on the bottom, you have this general ideas, epics, maybe something what is not very well defined. On the top, you have your user stories that you really know what to do with. So take your backlog and tilt it 90 degrees, like to my right, tilt it 90 degrees and put it on your Kanban system. And what you will see on the left, you will have your epics, you will have your ideas, you will have your not very well described requests, like upgrade this report for me, please. On the right-hand side of the upstream, so this tick, a red line in the middle, you have the requests that are already well described. And what's important, you can commit to doing them. And this commitment is super important because this is both sides commitment. Okay, so on one hand, upstream, everyone who is responsible for upstream says, this is the request that we understand. These are the requirements that we understand. This is something what we want you to deliver for us. And when you start working on it, we are not going to change our mind. Okay, so we are 100% sure. On the other hand, people from delivery, so right-hand side, my right-hand side from the commitment point, they say, we understand your request. We know what it is. We know there is technical feasibility to deliver it. We are capable to deliver it. We have capacity to deliver it. And I say, I repeat it a few times that this is two sides commitment, because I've met also in my life with situation that people just said, people from upstream, yeah? They just said, okay, you know, this is the request, deal with it. And the perception was that only delivery people are committing to something, and people from discovery, from upstream, they say, no, no, never mind. We can change our mind anytime. No, you cannot. This is two sides commitment. You want it to be delivered, you will deliver it, and you all agree to do it. And what's also important here is to have this minimum and maximum limits in upstream system. So let's come back for a second to our ice cream example. So you are at the front of the freezer. So you want to have this minimum limit. So say three tastes of ice cream, strawberry, pineapple, and chocolate. Yeah. So this is your minimum limit. But on the other hand, you want to also have your maximum limit. Because if you stand in the front of the freezer and you see 100 tastes of the ice cream, and you are just... you love 10 of them or maybe 20 of them, but you don't know this taste. Oh my God, what to do with this? And you know, the seller comes to you and asks, okay, so which taste do you want? And you say, oh my God, I reviewed only 50 of them and I don't know what the other 50 are about. You don't want to overburden your system, okay? So also introduce this maximum limits. This maximum limits in upstream are normally much higher than in downstream. But you want to have this two limits, so minimum options and maximum options. What if you don't work with backlog? Yeah, it happens. So here are a few really just very basic things you can start with. First of all, visualize the process of knowledge discovery. And if you have already visualized the process of delivery, this is very similar work. Yeah, so you just think what you do from the moment when idea appears in your backlog to the moment when, or the pool of ideas to the moment when you know that you want to deliver it. Okay, think about it, write it down, even create columns and deal with this the same as you deal with delivery. Discover it, not only the ideas, but also discover your system and improve it, improve it, improve it every day. This is what we do with everything in Kanban. Define commitment point. Commitment point is very important because it helps you to distinguish where is your upstream, where is your downstream, and where you say, yes, this is the work. Create explicit policies for managing options, for definition of ready, for triage, for everything that you need to deal with in upstream system, so you make things transparent. Introduce replenishment meeting. So again, this is the moment when you decide what to do next, what to pull into your delivery system, and understand the point of diminishing returns. The point of diminishing returns you can see here on this picture. So we can imagine this the way that on the horizontal line, we have time and cost. Yeah, so time flies and there is more and more and more cost. On the vertical line, we have increase in confidence or decrease in uncertainty, depending how you prefer to look at it. So when you start working on something, normally you don't need that much time, you don't need to bury that much cost to gather a lot of information very quickly. So the level of confidence increases rather quickly, but not that much time passed yet. But you will see that there is a point in time when you spend more and more time, more and more efforts. You pay more and more for surveys, for marketing research. And you see that actually you didn't learn too much or you learn nothing at all. This is the point of diminishing returns. This is the point, this is the moment when you should decide what to do next. Do you discard this idea? Do you invest in this idea and move on? Or maybe the circumstances don't allow you yet to make this decision. You need to shelve them. How to recognize this point of diminishing returns? Two small short tips. The first one is your replenishment meeting. So say you keep your replenishment meeting every week, like every Tuesday, like today. So last week we had our replenishment meeting. We talked about our ideas. And now we meet a week later. We review them again. And you see that actually nothing happened. Nothing changed. You didn't learn anything more. So it may be, of course, the situation that you need to spend more time, or maybe your replenishment meeting is held too often, so you should decrease the frequency. But maybe this is already the point of diminishing returns, and you need to decide now what to do next. And now the clients. You know, last year, it was already more than a year ago, I attended a class with Susanna Bartel and Bianca Hrifion, two wonderful trainers. And they taught me how to teach Kanban. And I remember Susanna coming to us every day, and almost every day we had the same conversation. Conversation is probably too much. But it reminded me, like I felt in the kindergarten, when a teacher came to us and she said, good morning, children. And then we said, good morning, dear teacher. Yeah. So it was the same in this TTT class, train the trainers. So Susanna came to us and she asked, how do we scale Kanban, dear children? Yeah. And dear children answered, we do more Kanban. So, you know, if you awake me 1 a.m. in the middle of the night, in the middle of the most beautiful dream in my life, and you ask me, how do we scale Kanban? I will answer, we do more Kanban. So this is how we scale Kanban. But why do I even talk about it? Because when you start doing discovery Kanban, when you start designing and applying all of these techniques to your upstream system, this is where you scale Kanban. And you know, when you have your delivery system, think about this graph of upstream and downstream. So we have your delivery system down here into downstream. Then you have your commitment point. Everything what's left on the commitment point is upstream. So when you start adding discovery process left of your commitment point, you make this process here wider. Okay, so from this process, you make it wider. And this is one of the dimensions of scaling Kanban, to make it more wide. Okay, so you don't need to, no, scaling Kanban is not about making it applicable for the whole organization in 1 month from now. No, you do it small steps, and sometimes you don't even realize that you already started scaling Kanban. And scaling Kanban in width, so make it wider and wider and wider, is probably one of the easiest way how you can start doing this. And upstream Kanban adds the client interface to your system and makes you even more aware of the client, because I realized that you have already thought about your client, that you try to address your client needs, but upstream system is really the interface with your client, and it helps you to start a meaningful discussion about the products and what is the value of the products that you build for them. You can learn all of these things from Kanban Maturity Model, of course, from the book. You can read this stuff at kmm.plus, where we map for you all of the content from Kanban Maturity Model and more. You can also learn these things in the class that we teach. The class is called Kanban for Design and Innovation. This is KDI class or part of our KMP bundle. As always, attending this webinar, you receive a discount for us for the classes. So KMP bundle, KDI class, or iKey, individual Kanban for Enterprise. Just put upstream code, or contact Lauren or me or anyone from our sales team, and we'll help you with that. So this is it from me. Thank you very much. I will stop sharing the screen right now and waiting for your questions.
Okay, so if you have any questions, please drop them in the Q&A box and we'll go through them now. Okay, so the first one. So can you elaborate on the real options aspect?
Yes. I just wonder, what would you like to learn more? So as I said, we apply real options in the situation of uncertainty. So when there is no uncertainty, it means that you don't need to have a choice, because you know what to do, you know what to choose. Actually, you don't choose. There's no uncertainty, you know what to do, yeah? But I bet that in most of the cases, let's say 99.9% of the cases, we rather don't know what future brings. And that's why we want to give ourselves a choice. So we don't want to have a situation that everything what's in our backlog is something that we need to deliver. And you may work in different environments. Some of them are more regulated, some of them are less regulated. So we normally apply the metric, health indicator metric, which is called discard rate. And, you know, discard rate, it talks about discard, but it's discarding options, but also it tells you more about shelving and investing options. And in one of the case studies that we use teaching about Kanban, the XIT case study, the discard rate was around 50%, which means that out of every 10 ideas, 5 were discarded. So only 5 were developed and moved further. And you may see different discard rates depending on the business. And some of them may have higher discard rates. I imagine like very creative companies, I guess in some game developers, development companies, they probably have very, very high discard rate, maybe 80, maybe 90%, which is okay. I worked for a few years in the bank, so our work was very regulated. I remember when GDPR came and we had to adjust all our reporting to the new rules, GDPR. So, you know, there was not too much choice. I don't want to say that we didn't have any choice because we had a choice in terms of how to do it. But it wasn't something that we could say, you know, never mind GDPR, who cares? Yeah, we had to do this. So the discard rate was much, much lower. And that's why we say that, we don't say that there is one particular discard rate you need to apply. You need to think what's a good discard rate, what's appropriate discard rate for your business, for your process, because even in one business, you may have different processes with different discard rate. So this is one of the aspects of the real options that you need to be aware of. The other aspect, it actually applies to real options, but also to the triage. It's rather psychological. So discarding options, but also from the triage perspective, saying no to things is very difficult. And we are not taught in our life, most of us, I don't want to say that everyone, but most of us is not taught in our life how to say no. So saying no to your clients. So if you are in downstream system and you receive requests from your upstream system and you need to say no to some of them, you need to discard some of them or advise discarding is very difficult. So this is another thing that we need to consider designing and applying the upstream system. Normally these decisions should be taken by the clients or by people responsible for the upstream parts, like product owners, product managers, business analysts, what to discard, what to invest in. But sometimes if you work in downstream and you are asked for advice, you are asked for assessing, for example, technical feasibility of an idea, you also need to say no. And yeah, so I would say that this is another aspect of real options. These two come to my mind as something additional to what I have said, but if you have more questions, just put them in Q&A.
Okay, thank you. So another question, can you use upstream Kanban and then later use Scrum for the delivery?
Yes. Yes, why not? Do it evolutionary. Mm-hmm. See what it brings.
Okay. And do you set WIP limits and manage the lead time in upstream Kanban?
This is more complex. I will try to answer quickly. So yes, you set WIP limits and you set minimum and maximum WIP limits. So this is what I touched shortly, giving you this ice cream example. So you want to have some minimum choice, say 3-5 tastes of ice cream, but you also don't want to have 100 tastes to choose, yeah, because this is too much and you overburden your system. So the problem with system overburdening with too much work, it's common for upstream and for downstream. Yeah? We are all people. So yes, you set WIP limits. With lead time, it's a bit more difficult because of the fact that you don't have only maximum WIP limits, but you also have a pool system in upstream. So, but there are situations that you need to take care for your lead time. The example that we normally use here is COVID vaccination. So what happened in the whole process of discovering knowledge about the vaccine against COVID was the upstream system. You know, it was research, development, testing. And lead time was very important there. Normally, you know, I am the fan of watching lead time, even in the upstream. So you are aware of what's going on and see you can see that maybe the work is not progressing, not because you are at the point of diminishing returns or you have replenishment meeting too frequently, but just because of the blockers or dependencies. So that's why I like calculating lead time or looking at lead time also in upstream, but it's not always required.
Okay, do you have any tips to help participants discard or shelve options and feel good about it?
I would say that feeling good about it is the mother of confidence. And there are studies from 2015 which say that people prefer to give wrong answer than say that they don't know. And I felt it. Not only felt, I survived the situation. And I know what they mean. So you are sitting at the steering committee. So you have all of the vice presidents or managing directors in the meeting, 15 of them. You are reporting the status of your project. You say that we just started working on this report, yeah? And they ask, okay, when it will be done? I say, I don't know. But when it will be done? Or we started a 2 years project, 2 years project, okay? It was a budget for it, people for it, contracted for it. And everyone knew this is 2 years project. And the second meeting, again, with the steering committee, where is your Gantt chart? Excuse me. Where is your Gantt chart? So I started to explain, no, I don't prepare Gantt chart. This is 2 years project. Actually, uncertainty level was somewhere up there, okay? But they wanted me to prepare a Gantt chart with all releases for the next 2 years. So what we are going to develop each Saturday for the next 2 years when I had no idea what we are going to do. And, you know, after a few discussions with them, I prepared this Gantt chart because I was sick and tired of saying that I don't know. We dealt with the situation in a different way. This is not the subject of this webinar. So it's possible to manage it, but I know how it's like. So this is very difficult to say, I don't know. I don't have enough information for the sake of my well-being, I preferred to say, we'll do it in a month, okay? This and this Saturday, it will be done. Of course it wasn't. Everyone knew, everyone in this room, including me and them, knew that it won't be done. But everyone, including me and them, were happy that I said that. Because it was easier a month later to say, oh, sorry, no, we need to postpone, apologies, blah, blah, blah. Then say a month earlier that I don't know, because uncertainty is too high. And this is something in people's brain that makes us feel really bad about uncertainty. But this is something that we need to deal with when we are in upstream. And to deal with it, we use this this real options techniques, this discovering knowledge technique. And also, you know, discussion with the client. I didn't say one thing, but upstream is maturity level 3. Okay, so this is not something what you do when you just start your work, you are doing your personal Kanban to do in progress done. You don't apply upstream system. Upstream system is something what we do maturity level 3. And this is already the moment when your system is fit for purpose. And with upstream, you make it even more fit for purpose. When you know your client, when your delivery system is established and it's working. So this is when you start really talking to your clients in a position that allows you to say, I don't know, that allows you to say no, and that allows you to be confident about this answer.
Okay.
Really but sorry, Lauren, one more thing. But I see that this topic is important, and I was already thinking about making a webinar about it. So webinar about it will come, how to deal with this. But I need half an hour, okay, to talk about it. So give us time and we'll do it separately.
Okay. So is there an ideal discard rate?
No. No, this is health indicator. You just need to look at your business and your process, your product. Your discount rate can be 5%, 10%, or 95%. And all of them will be fine until they are applicable and appropriate for your product.
Okay, thanks. I saw some in the chat too. Someone, what if the organization has a backlog, an old version that they have to deliver everything? How can you help? How can you use upstream Kanban to help this particular group to understand they don't need to do it all?
Oh, so this is a changing of the mindset more than the backlog itself. So I always start with trying to understand what's in this backlog. And what we also do, and I didn't talk about it, maybe I should, is what we call the time guillotine. And it really helps. This is rather brutal, but it helps and it works. So what you do with time guillotine? It needs to be clearly stated in the policy and in the rules that if something sits in your backlog or in any of the columns in your process for too long, and this too long needs to be precise. So maybe too long is 1 week, or for someone else, too long is half a year. So if it stays here too long, then you just discard it. And I say it's brutal, but sometimes this is the only thing that you can do. Again, giving you an example, I was once responsible for backlog of, to not lie to you, more than 2,000 items. And some of them were there for a week, some of them were there for 3 years. So I knew I'm not able to manage these things. Yeah. So what I did, I applied time guillotine. I didn't know back then that this is time guillotine, which said that all items that are older than 3 months will be discarded if you don't come back to me in 2 weeks. And I send it to all people who created this items in the backlog. Some of them didn't even work, so I was not able to have any confirmation what it is. And feedback was not very, you know, encouraging, so most of the people didn't come back to me. So I sent reminder, of course, after 1 week. Then a day before I did it, I sent another reminder saying, you know, tomorrow I'm going to close everything that's older than 3 months. And I did it. And it started. How could you do it? How was it possible? Who allowed you to do it? Why? So I had emails, I had chats. It was pre-COVID, so I was catching the corridor. Anya, how could you do it? But I did it. You had free information. What is the rule? What is the policy? And what I'm going to do? You had 2 weeks to just say, no, don't do it. I will think about it later. So yes, I had to open some of them again, but it was the case of the mother, which I told you about. So if mother really loves her children, she will come back to you and she will ask you to open this request again. But it's easier to open some of them again than manage 2,000 items in your backlog for the next few years. So you can try with time guillotine and apply time guillotine frequently to your backlog, to your process. This can be done all together with real options and triage.
Okay. When speaking of vocabulary definitions, is there any difference between upstream Kanban or discovery Kanban?
Historically, yes. If you look at Patrick's case study and you will read more about it. What I really encourage you to do, you can see that what we call right now upstream Kanban was in fact two parts. So discovery plus experts, expert boards. So discovery was this pure process of identifying, understanding requests, and then experts part of the Kanban system was that the point where two sides, so discovery and delivery, met and they discussed what happened. Right now, we just unified this understanding and we just call upstream discovery. Also, you know, from the terminology perspective, I guess not all of you here are English native speakers, and I'm not sure whether you tried to translate upstream and downstream to your languages. I tried to Polish and I gave up. Even, you know, consulting with my colleagues who teach Kanban in Poland, we all gave up. We just call it upstream and downstream because translating into Polish is a nightmare. It's ugly if I try to do it. So discovery, it's just a better name, but it also gives the sense of what we are doing in upstream system. So yeah, from how we teach it, there is no difference. It's more about the design. So how you want to design it. And there are different ways for doing it.
Okay, there's quite a few questions about how to go about setting WIP limits and if your WIP limits from the upstream should affect your downstream WIP limits at all. I don't know if you can talk about that generally.
Generally, you know, the general answer will probably satisfy everyone on no one, but I will try. Experimenting. So you just try, and this is always my advice also for the downstream, for delivery. You try, you set up your initial WIP limits, you see how your system reacts to them. Do you see a lot of things waiting, or do you see maybe some things piling up, a phase, one phase before another? And then you see that you need to adjust your WIP limits to make your work flowing and not stacking and waiting. Also in upstream, not like in downstream, in upstream, the WIP limit is decreasing. So say you have three phases, like, I don't know, analysis of the requirements, risk, and creating MVP. Oh. So analysis of requirements, you may have WIP limits like 24 to 48. Yeah. And then in risk analysis, 12 to 24. And then in MVP, 6 to 12. Yeah. So you need to apply this concept of funnel into your upstream funnel, into your upstream system. Yeah. So the WIP limits are decreasing and it should force you to discard some ideas. But what WIP limits exactly you should have, I will not answer this because this is the same with discard rate. It all depends on your product. I'm sorry to say that. I know that you hate this answer, but this is how it is.
Okay. How can you do user research in a Kanban environment? So example, how could you do the flow of persona mapping?
I'm not sure whether I'm able to answer this question quickly. If you don't mind, whoever asked this question, we'll save all of the questions anyway. And I will think about it after the webinar and maybe we'll drop a post or at least we'll come back to you with an answer.
Okay. Have you found a good way for teaching an unsupportive client that is not involved in the process how to become an active part of the task scoping?
Teaching. Yes, okay, I can call it teaching. I told you about this 2 years project where I had to prepare the Gantt chart. So what happens? Gantt chart is a separate story, but when we started to deliver, We did it based on the procedures. So actually, we prepared requirements based on the procedures that were available in our financial department. And our business analysts prepared the requirements based on it. Our delivery team just created a code report. We tested it. It was working, yeah. Then we did the delivery. And we were super happy about this delivery. Our client was too, because they've been waiting for it. And they had a lot of plans related to this delivery. And they started to use it, and it was like, oh my God, what is this? Yeah, so no. No, guys, what you did is crap. You need to change it. So we started to receive a lot of change requests. But also because they used this product, they have seen that we build this product for them. And I don't really care what is the name of the report, is it working this or that way, until it's working for them and they make a value of it. So they started on one hand to create this change request for us that we need to update this, and this in this ready report. But on the other hand, they wanted to be involved in the process of making decision. And again, this is psychologically difficult because I was product owner back then, and it was challenging me. So I wasn't the final source of truth and knowledge for my team anymore. I had to allow client to step in. But it really started to work because not only there were representatives of the clients, so we had different moments of time between 15 and 20 people engaged in this process. But on one hand, they were able to quickly verify whether what we built makes sense for them or not. So some of the ideas that we had were discarded, you know, at the source. So removed from the pool of ideas. They started to add something new, or they helped us with sequencing these items, saying that, you know, we use this particular report once per month, and we use this particular report once per year, or this client is big, this client is small. Change the sequencing, change the schedule of work. This report is more important for us. Or we have just finished cycle working on this report. We don't need it in another 6 months. Okay, you can postpone it. So this is the way how they felt they have impact on what we do. On the other hand, because they started to work with the product that we built and they started to see that it's not working perfectly, they had to revise how they work and how they pass this knowledge to us. So sometimes it came from us, but they were willing to do it. Sometimes it came from them. That we should meet, we should discuss, we should look at the requirements. Because if your client doesn't understand what you wrote about their process, it's not a good sign. So that's why it came somehow organically. So we, of course, we tried to engage our clients at the beginning, but they said, no, we don't have time, just take the procedure and do it. Yeah. And then when they started to use it, they realized that no, they have to be engaged. I don't want to say that you need to do it in such a, again, brutal way. So they need to see the defect. They need to see that it's not working to be engaged. But it helps them to understand that their involvement, their engagement is really required if they want to see the value from that product. So this is also how I had contact with upstream system, how I started to design upstream system. And we ended up with delivery system, with upstream system for business, for our business colleagues, and also kind of experts board where our analysts, developers, and again, these representatives met and discussed whether we can deliver this thing, this requirement or not.
Okay, thank you. So we had a lot of really great questions today, and we have answers to all of them, but unfortunately, we're out of time. So if you still want to get your question answered, email us support@djaa.com, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can.
Yes, also we'll take all of these questions that you have here in chat, in Q&A. As I said, I'm really grateful for these questions because they helped me to write the blog post for you. So please, let's stay in touch and look for answers to your questions somewhere in the written form, okay?
Okay, thank you, everyone. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Have a nice day. Bye-bye.